Hi students, let us continue with the programmable interrupt controller. In the previous video, I explained about the pin diagram of 8259. So 8259 is a 28 pin configuration. Now let us see what is the internal architecture of that pin 8259. So this is an internal architecture. These all pins will the structure of this 8259. So here is the data bus buffer, read write control logic. So for every interfacing circuit, whatever you are taking, these will be compulsory: data bus buffer, read write control logic. And coming to here, cascading buffer comparator is there. Its cascading buffer is checking, means comparing which signal is having the cascading output. So these are the cascading, three cascading pins will be connected to cascade buffer, and SP by EN bar, based on this signal, these cascading lines will be active. And it having one control logic. This control logic will be connected to the microprocessor. Means the 8251 is interrupting the processor by saying that a valid interrupt is occurred, valid signal is occurred from peripheral devices. So whenever the processor is ready, it sends the acknowledgement to 8259 with the help of this control logic. Then the control logic will intimate it to everything. So these are the interrupt requesters IR0 to IR7. So each interrupt request is came from the peripheral devices. So that interrupt request first is placed in the IRR, interrupt request register. So based on the priority, so that priority will be resolved by the priority resolver. So this is a judge. It is going to be decided which interrupt has to be sent first. So whatever the, based on the priority resolver, that one interrupt is selected as the highest priority, that will be placed in service register. Whenever it is placed in service register, then that interrupt only sends to the processor. So the data that is present in service register means that is going to be serviced to the microprocessor. So that will be ready to service, that will be sent to the processor. And here is the interrupt mask register. So actually this 8 data bus lines D0 to D7 or transferred data or transferred between microprocessor and 8259. So the data that can be transferred to microprocessor and 8259, it should be in the command word, status information, or interrupt type numbers. And coming to the cascading lines, these cascading lines are used to cascade system where number of 8259 ICs are interconnected. Suppose when different 8259s are interconnected, ICs are interconnected, it is going to be decided in master or slave configuration to expand the number of interrupt request inputs from 8 to as high as 64. So here only 8 interrupt requests are there. Suppose if you want to add some more, up to 64 interrupt requests, you have to take different 8259 ICs. So different 8259, whenever you take different 8259 ICs, so the one which is presently operating, that should be a master and others will be slave. So once that work is over, that becomes a slave, the next serving device will become master. So that everything will be decided by the cascading buffer. So this cascading buffer comparator will be used whenever you are using number of 8259 ICs or interconnected. And this SP by EN bar active low is used to indicate the current device is acts as master or slave. Means it indicating is this device is acting master or slave. That will be decided. Now let us see one by one. First is the interrupt request register. So what is the operation this interrupt request register will perform? Let me write the points so that you will understand. Interrupt request register. So what's the interrupt request register will do? So this IRR, interrupt request register, keeps track. The operation that it can perform is, it keeps track of which interrupt input are asking for service. Suppose all 8 are asking for service, just all interrupt requests are placed in this register. IR0 to IR7 will be keep track of in this service, okay, of which interrupt input are asking for service. And also, if an interrupt input has an interrupt signal on it. Has an interrupt signal on it. Then corresponding bit, whatever the corresponding bit that it consisting of, that corresponding bit in the interrupt request register will be set. Okay, so this is about the interrupt request register. So next one is the interrupt mask register. So let us see what is this interrupt mask register, what is the operation that it can do in the architecture. Interrupt mask register. Interrupt mask register is used to IMR is used to disable or enable the individual interrupt input. So the interrupt mask register is used to disable or enable the individual interrupts. And also here each bit in this register, each bit in this IMR register corresponds to the interrupt input with the same number. So this is the operation. Next, coming to the in-service register. So what is the operation that in-service register can perform? In-service register. The in-service register the in-service register keep tracks, it's always keep tracks which interrupt input are currently being served. It's currently being served by the microprocessor, so and it is going to be serviced, everything will be keeping track by the in-service register. The in-service register keep tracks which interrupt input are currently being serviced. And the corresponding bit will be set in the in-service register. So this is the operation that in-service register can perform. And the next one is a priority resolver. Next component that is present in this architecture is the priority resolver. So it's just checking which interrupt is having the highest priority. The priority resolver acts as a judge. So I said it is going to be decide which interrupt is having highest priority. So the priority resolver acts as a judge that determines if and when an interrupt request on one of IR input gets serviced. So which interrupt request has to be get serviced, that will be decided by the priority resolver. And the last component that is present in this architecture is cascade buffer. So now let us see what is a cascade buffer. Cascade buffer or the comparator, so which is going to be checked. This block, this cascade buffer block stores and compares the IDs. So as I said, different IDs will be there. If you connect more than one 8259, so this block stores and compares the IDs of all 8259s used in the system. So if you connected more than one 8259 in the system, this block stores all the IDs of that 8259s and the three IO input output pins CS02, CS2 or output, means these three I/O pins when CA0 to 2 are output, when 8259 is used as master. Suppose 8259 is using as a master, this pin acts as an output. Or else, the same pins, that is a CA0 to 2 or CA0 to 2 or input, when 8259 is in slave mode. When it is an output, it acts as a master. When it is an input, 8259 is acts as a slave mode. 8259 is master mode. If it is a master mode, this 8259 is a master mode. It sends the ID of interrupting slave device in these lines. So whenever it is 8-5 in slave, suppose it is in slave, the selected will send its pre-programmed vector address on the data bus during the next INTF pulse. So this is the operation that this cascading pins will do. So it's just the main thing here is this cascading buffer consisting of three cascading pins. Those acts as an input as well as output. When it acts as an output, when 8-5 is in master mode, when acts as an input, when 8-5 is in slave mode. So everything that whether it is a master mode or slave mode, that will be decided by this cascade buffer. So these cascade buffers will be active whenever you are connected more than one 8259 to the 8086 microprocessor. So this is about the internal architecture of 8259, the programmable interrupt controller. Thank you.